1.5% here. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Good evening to 1.5% here. So it's my sincere thanks to our Chancellor Ma'am and President Sir for providing us the facility. And I also thank our Vice Chancellor Ma'am, Dr. Sashikrapa, and the Pro Vice Chancellor Sir, Dr. Lovasamma Sir, and the Register, Dr. S.S. Rao Sir, and the Director of Administration, Dr. Sundari Ma'am, and the Controller of Examinations, Dr. Ignis Sebastian Prabhu. And I should also thank our special people from our own school, the HODs, Dr. Ramesh Kumar Sir and Narendra Kumar Sir. And my special thanks are due to Professor Dr. Wilson Arumi, Pro Vice Chancellor, who gave us all the facilities and moral supports, support to conduct the event. Yeah. And coming to the today's speaker, Dr. Vinod S. Ravindran, who is the State Coordinator, Netfish, EMBIDA, Sub-Regional Division, Tuticorin, Tamil Nadu, and he is going to deliver a talk on marine fisheries of India. And he is specialized in deep sea tuna long lining. And in addition to that, he is basically a marine biologist. He has done his master's, MPhil, and PhD, everything in marine biology. He is well versed with the identification of marine organisms. And he has 4 years of teaching experience when he was working in MS Ananyam Sundarar University. In STMRI, and he has around 18 years of research experience since he is doing his studies in Annamalai University. And presently he is a state coordinator. Before this, he was a director of Center for Coastal and Marine Research Tuticorin for about 2 years. And before that, he was working as an assistant professor in Sugandhi Devadasan Marine Research Institute for 5 years, and before that he was working for 4 years as a project associate in Gujarat Ecology Society, Gujarat. And he was working as a marine biologist for some time in Environmental Impact Assessment Studies with Arnica Consultants, Mumbai. And he has guided 2 PhDs, successfully completed 5 MPhil students, 2 MSc students, while he was doing academic related activities in SDMRI. And to his credit, he has published 14 research articles and 3 book chapters and 4 10-bank submissions. And to the government, he has submitted a lot of reports, like 4 reports, and marine environmental monitoring reports, 9. And paper presented, special lectures, it's around 8. And seminar, symposium, training programs attended, as well as organized, is 15 numbers. And not only that, we also ran 3-4 projects sponsored by Government of India, like Ministry of Environment Forest, University Grants Commission, and DST Sir, and other agencies. That was 57. Lacks. And we people, we travel through roads and trains, maybe sometimes air, but he most of the time he used cruise or ship transport for studying marine organisms, environmental monitoring, and so on. He has visited 54 times almost East Coast of India, West Coast of India, and the whole Tamil Nadu, and most of the Gujarat coast, and as a whole Andaman Nicobar Islands, I can say. And in addition to that, he has conducted a lot of extension activities, maybe for the past 5-6 years, he's doing it. He has conducted more than 700 extension programs, and he has trained 20,000 fishermen or more. So above all, he is a very good friend of me, and we were studying together in he is in marine biology all the period. We were under same umbrella, like we together studied or did research under Professor Kadir sir. Very proud to say this word. And with this small introduction, I invite Dr. Vinodesh Ravindran to share your experience with us. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everybody. First of all, I thank our NetFish MPED amidst so many of official duties they have let me to sit here. Secondly, the organizers of this program, the Satyabhama University organizers, who have given a good opportunity amidst of this pandemic to come here and share our views with everybody. This is a very good opportunity, and this is the need of the time also. Actually, in this pandemic time, this is the first webinar I am attending. So I am also not a very technical savvy about these computers and all. So there was a little bit struggle there with this. Dr. Mazalamani told that he has given a brief introduction, but it is very large introduction. I do not know how he has collected so many things. I am thankful to him for his very good introduction, but I have to live up to it. That is my problem now. And as he said, we have lived together in deep storms while we are working for our mangrove studies under Dr. Kadraisan and Dr. Professor Kannan. We were living together. We were in Porto Novo. So with this introduction, I will just jump into my topic, because I do not know how far it will go, whether it will be little less, otherwise it will be more. I do not know. I have not spoken this before. And I see Dr. Chandrasekharan sir here, a senior member of this group. Good afternoon, sir. And I wish all the organizing people and my friends over for this webinar a very good afternoon. First of all, I will start with the marine fisheries of India. When Dr. Mazalamani called me, he told, you know, you speak something on marine fisheries of India. And I told, sir, it is a very large topic to cover with. But however, I will try, I will attempt. I will not say that it is not possible, but it is a difficult one. I will try to justify the subject. Okay, marine fisheries of India. So now, is my screen visible, and am I audible for everybody?
Yes.
Okay. So now in the screen, I have put the geomorphology of Peninsular India. So Peninsular India has these three sides, oceans. One side, the Arabian Sea, the Bay of Bengal, and the Indian Ocean. So we are in a very prime location for having a very good fishery, because of our demographics and our positioning in the ocean. So there are two things. Dr. Mazalamani, but I am not able to change the slides. Can you give it in my control? Can I have the slides to be changed in my control? Anything like that? No, you will only control that.
It is not possible to control you. You can just tell the next slide, so that Dr. Mazalamani will operate. Okay.
Okay. Because I do not remember the next slide. That is the problem. Which preparation? Okay, no problem. Okay. The last one. The Peninsular India slide. Okay. So now the first part is our continental shelf area. The continental shelf area is a very rich zone for fisheries because of so many coastal processes. The upwelling process is there in the continental shelf area, and a lot of rivers also drain into the continental shelf area. So the waters are very rich and nutrient. So the fishery is very rich in that area. In all these 50 years, I think next slide. In all this, the continental shelf, I have one problem. I am not able to actually, if I can reduce this, I can take my slide also. So the continental shelf area is very rich, and India has a very long coastline of about 8,129 kilometers square of coastline. And the exclusive economic zone is also very high, with about 2.02 million kilometers square. The proudness, the weightage of the continental shelf, I have been telling. But fishing is very profoundly being done in the continental shelf area. And very focusedly also, fishing is taking place in the continental shelf area. Though we have the right to go far till the exclusive economic zone, fishing is very much concentrated in the continental shelf area. Please show me the peninsular slide. Okay, so this is what you have to understand from this slide. We have a continental shelf area, mostly in the 200 meter depth area, it is demarcated as a continental shelf. And the next thing is the exclusive economic zone, which is, okay. So the next thing is the exclusive economic zone. Now, as far as India is concerned, India has grown largely in the capture fisheries from 1950 to 2020, with about a production of 0.75 million metric tons to 12.59 million metric tons. If you see the fish production, it has gradually increased in due course of this years. See, now you might see why we are telling that 1950 to this much time we are having that capture fisheries. The reason is because in 1950 we got after our independence in 1947, we have to say that we were directionless. It is like a driver jumping out of the bus when he was driving, and suddenly someone near that seat goes to the driver's seat. So he is clueless about how much fuel the bus has, where the bus is going. So this was the condition after 1947 when the Britishers left us. There were no collectors in the collector office, tahsildars, teachers in the school, officers in every section. So the nation was heading towards a very big famine. In fact, not heading. It was undergoing a famine, like famine condition. And the then Prime Minister of India asked the ICAR to say something about, do something about this famine condition. What to do about this famine condition? They were trying about the Green Revolution. But Green Revolution, they changed the crops, they brought in quick growing crops. Earlier days, the crops were taking 6 months. And in that time also, lot of pest problem, locust, and crops will die up. So it was not sufficient to meet the protein needs of the country or feed the people of the country. So Jawaharlal Nehru asked ICAR, well, how can we tackle this problem? So ICAR gave the idea to him that we have lot of coastal resources. We have lot of coastal resources. So how these coastal resources can be exploited? We do not have anything in our country at that time. We were all artisanal fishermen. We were only doing shore seam fishing. Otherwise, non-mechanized catamaran kind of fishing. With non-mechanized catamaran kind of fishing and shore seam fishing, the fishes which was harvested was very low. Number one, the harvest was very low. Another thing, if at all they were harvesting also, they cannot store the fish. There is no proper storage facility, no preservation techniques, nothing was there, no infrastructure was there. So he immediately asked, what can be done about this? Then they suggested that Norway is a country, very small country, but they are having a very high fishery in their place. So a team of Norwegians came to India. And they introduced mechanized fishing, that is trawl net. But in that time, they specified clearly the trawl engine speed, the length of the boat, how many years, what should be the rotation of the phishing patch and everything they notified, and they taught us the technique of crawl. So in the continental shelf area, it was not harvested for thousands of years before. So now they got wonderful catches of fishes in the continental shelf area. Mostly it was all pinfish, that means shrimps and pinfish. In those days, actually shrimp was not, today if you get a plate of shrimp, you will release it like anything. But in those days, shrimp was not at all eaten by anybody. It was called a poochi in some places of Tamil Nadu. Poochi means insect. So they did not even think of eating this shrimp. Nowadays, it is a very high value sea product. So now in this slide, whatever you are seeing, is a growth from 1915 to 2007. When it is put till 2007, it's 1950 I will start. Phase one is starting. Only mechanization has been introduced by the Norwegians. Then we do not know the technique. Then government of India sanctioned a lot of subsidies to them to get boats, trained personnel, and now the business has started. Slowly from 1965 to 86, the business was growing. Now we have learned the technique. Now we know how to drive boats, how to extract these things. We have infrastructure, we have storage facilities, and we have export farms also, which have started to come. In 1972 only, the Marine Products Export Development Authority was commissioned. So that was the initiation of marine products export, intensification of marine products export in the country. Till 2007, intensified phase. Intensified means we know a lot of technique and we are masters of the art now. So now we are saturated with whatever we have, and we have started to overdo things than whatever was prescribed by the Norwegian Commission. So now till 2007, I should say, there was a saturation of our mechanized force and the resources available. That was the break-even point. That was the break-even point, I should say. From 2007 onwards, 17 and 20, 13 years, I have not put it in the slide, but it is over-exploitation, and we are exploiting above the threshold, and we have crossed all the limits set by the earlier authorities. Anyhow, now this is the condition. We are getting a lot of fish from the ocean. Now this is done. Now, where we are in the world countries in terms of marine fish production? So now we are third in the terms of marine fish production, next to China, Indonesia, and we are third, India. It's a very proud position, because China has control over a lot of sea area, including they are battling for the South China Sea also. It's a big political issue. So they are having control over wider places of the ocean. And where we are in our Indian scenario, what is the marine production is in lakh tons. If we see, Gujarat is the first coastal state because of its long coastline and very enriched waters, and the number of fishing vessels also. Gujarat is the number one state in fish production. You can see the numbers. Participants don't bother about the numbers at all. These numbers are for technicians, statisticians, scientists and policy makers. Now, having come to this one-day seminar, now you have to understand what these things are about. So, if you want to go in detail, it is like the cow which takes lot of food and keeps in its mouth, and when it is getting rest time, it cuts you. So, now that has to be your condition also. The slides are all available, it is all in public. So, you can take it, but don't worry about the numbers. Just see, Gujarat is the first state, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, followed by Maharashtra, Karnataka, Kerala, West Bengal, Odisha, Goa. All other states are also contributing, but in minimum quantities. Next. So what do we exploit? What we are taking from the ocean? What is our commercial exploitation of the coasts? What are we taking away from the ocean? It is fin fishes. There are 1,400 varieties of fin fishes. And in that, commercial species we exploit in commercial way, 263 species of fin fishes, 15 species of pinnates, and 8 species of cephalopods. These are the commercially exploited species. Next time. So this is a list. Don't bother about so many things are there. Even when I read, I could not make out few species. What the whatever the dimensions did not come to my mind also. So participants need not worry about that. Participants in the sense, I have categorized the participants into three people. One, experts, whose knowledge will be definitely over. Okay, I have seen lot of experienced persons on the list. Second type is the student category, right? My target mainly today is the student category, and the experts can advise me wherever I am going out of way or otherwise. Chandrasekharan sir is laughing at. Okay, coming to the point. So that is a list of species whichever have been exploited by the from the Indian subcontinent. So now just to see this, spend 2 seconds on this slide. I have put, this is represented from a CMFRA publication. So this is the pointed region show which area shows from which area which type of fishes are caught. Experts and whoever is very much focused on this can read from this. And my student friends, just have a look at it. So these are the type fish varieties which are caught from the Indian peninsular region, including the Andaman Nicobar and Lakshadweep archipelagos. Right, next one. Dr. Maslamani, I want you to open that other PDF file which I have sent you. Can you do that for me? Dr. Maslamani?
Yes, yes.
Okay, that another PDF file was there. That was full of photos of fishes. You just open that photos for the participants. Okay, till you open, I will continue. So now we have a large coastline. We have been taught about the techniques of catching fish by a foreigner. We have grown in phases, and now we are expert of the trade, and now we have started over exploiting. How do we exploit? How do we exploit these resources? So there in India, there are 5 major areas which are used for the exploitation of resources. Trawl nets. One is trap, one is gear. Trap is how we go, and gear is what we make use of to catch the fishes. Okay. So what are all the traps? 3 types. One is mechanized. Mechanized is something which runs by a power, and which are larger boats, and motorized, mostly called pallams in Tamil, and not non-motorized is catamaran and row boats kind of. So people take, these are the traps, and people take trawl nets, bag nets, hook and lines, gill nets to catch the fishes. So see, these are some varieties of fishes. In due course, you will come across so many words like sardine, mackerel. Whatever you eat, you will be interested. You just see where these species are available. Don't put much brain into this. Okay. So now this is ribbon fish, lizard fish, bullseye, then crustaceans, shrimps, cuttlefish, crabs, Indian salmon, pomfrets, black pomfret, red fin beams, rays, sharks. Okay, so now when I am telling about all these fishes in the late part of the webinar, you can remind yourself of whatever photograph you have seen. Otherwise also you can say, so it is put in Kerala, it is usually a pelagic process. Okay, so you can make use of this file to find out what fishes I have mentioned in the webinar. Next slide. So five major gears. Next one. So these are the gears. Just see, this is a gill net. See, now this picture shows you a gill net. Gill net is just suspended from a boat. Whichever fish goes across that get caught by its gill. So that is gill net. Gill net is placed in two places. One is pelagic. Pelagic is the upper water column. One is bottom. And the other is, this is trawl net. So the first figure which you see, this figure is a midwater trawl, and this is a bottom trawl, and this is a pelagic trawl, and also a pair trawl. See that there are two boats engaged in fishing in a pair trawler. This is a bottom trawl. Next one. So this is gill net, and gill net is just suspended in the water, and whatever passes get caught. And this is a bottom set gill net, which is set at the bottom with some floats. This is the float and some anchors, and demersal fishes are mostly caught in the bottom set gill net. And the next one is purseine, and the next one is purseine. Purseine, just like a round, one boat will stand. And one shoal of fishes. Shoal means a group of fishes is called as a shoal, school, different kinds of terminologies are used. So one shoal of fishes is being surrounded by a boat and it is caught. So one problem with this purseine net is the purseine can surround any fish. It can be a juvenile fish, otherwise an adult fish. It surrounds an adult fish. If it surrounds sardines, which will not grow maximum 15-20 centimeters, so that is fair enough. That is very good. But when it targets smaller fishes, pools of fishes, then that becomes a destructive fish. Then the next fishing type is hook and line fishing. Hook and line fishing is of two types. One is demersal hook and line, and one is pelagic hook and line. Pelagic, when I say, think it is in the upper water column. Demersal, when I say, it is in the lower water column. Next, please. So this is the craft. See, one is the motorized boat, and one is a non-motorized catamaran, and the another one is a trawler. See, there is a trawl board fitted over here. This is the difference between a trawler and a gill netter. A gill netter will not have this back portion ornamentations of that otter board and all these things. Okay. So they will have a lot of 8 to 10 tons of gill nets, which I showed you earlier now, that will be just suspended in the water. So these are the crabs and gears which are used in Indian fishing. Next one. Then another type of net is used, which is called as the Behundi or dole net. My good friend Dr. Atanure's photograph is this. He has supplied. And see that it is put like a bag on the sea. Whenever the pool of fishes passes through the bag, it is caught in the bag and retained. The problem with this dole net is, as told by him, he says, we don't have bag nets in this portion of our country. West Bengal, Odisha has a lot of bag nets. The mesh size will be 4 to 5 millimeters. So it will retain most of, see this original picture, there are a lot of juveniles which are being caught. Killing the juveniles is a crime. So if we don't get bigger fishes, commercially viable fishes in due course, if we kill the juvenile without it reaching the age or size at first maturity, if it has not spawned for one season, then that resource is completely a waste. Okay, next slide. So now, worldwide, where we are in capture fisheries, now we are in 2016, we are in second place in the capture fisheries in 2018. So now we have caught a lot of fish, and how do we use it? We have caught fishes from the ocean, and how do we use them? 70% or 78% of the fishes are going as marketed as fresh fish, no preservation. It is going at fresh fish. No preservation means little ice here and there. The people will take to your house or whatever it is. It is just freezing, curing, canning. These three things are the export-oriented items. Freezing, 8%. Curing. Curing means drying, putting salt or any other preparation. That is another 4%. Canning. Canning in this canning is very negligible. Though we do it, it is not represented in this pie chart itself. So it has come zero. So that is what we are doing. But in a small nation like Sri Lanka, they are freezing more fishes than us. They are curing more fishes than us. So they are getting a lot of export revenue. That is our drawback, what I would say. We are as a nation getting so much of stuff. We are third in the world production earlier and now second in the world production. But we are freezing very little fishes and marketing fish fresh 78%, and that is also lost in post-harvest losses. So the marine export has definitely improved, especially in this decade, in the last decade. And so from 7,200 crores to now it has reached 45,000 crores thanks to the effort of MPDA and the various heads of the institute for the prevailing 15 years. They have the utmost effort of the people at the Marine Products Export Development Authority has increased the sales and export of the marine fish. Export, the thing is that if I get the fish, I get the fish for 50 rupees. For 200 rupees, my afternoon budget is over. So how will a fish market merchant get a very large gain from whatever I get? I, in the sense, most of the common men in this country. But when it is going for exports, the thing is different. It is, we are paid in dollars. We get a lot of foreign exchange. Due to foreign exchange, our GDP increases. So there are a lot of factors. So export is the main target, should be the main target of catching good fishes. So the item-wise exports are, frozen shrimp is the most preferred item for exports. And fin fishes, cuttlefish, squids and dried items comes after that. And in quantity also, we are exporting the maximum to Japan. That is most part, 40% of our catch, export-oriented fishes are sent to Japan. Next to America, equally to the European Union. Okay. Now we are talking about fisheries. How Dr. Ravindran, how suddenly in this slide, fisher focus come? Yes, fisher focus come. Because without fishermen, without fisheries, there is no need for exploitation of the fishes at all. Without human, there is no need for exploitation of the fishery resources. And fishermen are the engines of extracting fishes from the ocean. And Tamil Nadu has the highest population of fishermen as far as India is concerned, which is followed by Kerala and Andhra Pradesh. What is this? I just want to give a breaker for you. Just I was thinking, whatever I am presenting is not mine. I have copied it from so many sources, okay. But with the thing that it is Ravana, a 10-headed, I will call him a king, okay. So 10 heads are there. So when I came into this presentation, my colleagues are status of Indian fisheries. See, you know, you can say about the status of Tamil Nadu fisheries, but how will you say about the status of Indian fisheries? Very prestigious organization such as Satya Bhama is conducting this seminar. So somebody will knock you down. So we will also come to the support. So today I have taken the support of 9 others to come for the presentation. 9 other state coordinators who are coordinating the activities of fisheries of MPDA is here. and they have contributed a lot to this thing. From each state, it is not my presentation. They have sent their slides and they have given the input. When I showed this Ravana photo in a college, the same presentation earlier, one young chap stood up and asked, "Sir, I have a doubt." Then I told, "I know what your doubt is about Ravana, but I am not going to answer that doubt because you will put me in trouble." Most of the participants should have known that doubt about Sri Lanka and the Ayodhya issue. I am not coming into that. Okay. Now the first thing we will go come from the west coast of India. So the largest state is the Gujarat in terms of fishing. See Bombay duck. This is Bombay duck. This is slender and sweet. When you put in your mouth, that will dissolve like anything. This fish will dissolve in your mouth. Panjumudai we call in Tamil. It will dissolve in your mouth. The Bombay duck fishery is the biggest fishery in Gujarat. Next one. So now another interesting fact. Just this is a follow-up of all the interesting facts also. So Rincodon typus is a fish, the largest fish in the ocean. How large it is? It is large as a bus. One bus, if we see, that is one Rincodon typus. But this fish was heavily hunted in the coast of Gujarat for its fins and its commercially valuable meat and other parts of the body. So it was in IUCN, though just keep the earlier IUCN status is there, that this fish, the IUCN status shows that this fish is vulnerable. So one Swamiji told that she is like a daughter-in-law coming to our coast for breeding. So you have to celebrate. And our Prime Minister, the then Chief Minister of Gujarat, started an initiative for this Rincodon typus. And thanks to all the efforts, and now this has become a breeding ground in Gujarat for this Rincodon typus. Next. So these are the fishery of Maharashtra. There are a lot of major fishes. But Maslamani, should I finish exactly 5 o'clock?
Yeah, you can.
Okay. No, accordingly, I will deal with the slides.
Okay.
So now the earlier slide, Maharashtra. Maharashtra's problem is there are a lot of coastal effluents which go into the sea. They see, they make bull trawling, that is the bear trawling which we showed you in the earlier slide. And light fishing is also done in Maharashtra. So a lot of resource damage is being done to the stocks of Maharashtra. Next one. Then Karnataka and Goa also, lot of fishes are being caught. As I showed you, lot of fishing gears are being used, traps are being used. That is common for all the states. But problems in fishing, violations of the fishing acts are also very common. The MFRAs, Marine Fisheries Regulation Act. The MFRAs have been formulated in all the coastal states of India from 1980 onwards. The problem is today is 2020. 2010-20, 40 years, we do not have proper implementation of the MFRA. Everybody knows what is, what if we do what resources will be lost. It is all put in the MFRA. The MFRA has not been designed very carelessly. It has been written very carefully by the experts, but enforcement in the field, I should say, is very close to zero. That is our valuable fishery resources are being lost. Next one. So Karnataka and Goa also, the same type of thing is there. The landing of juvenile fishes are very low. As I said to you before, if you kill the juveniles, then everything is lost. The fishery resources, total stock will be lost in another cycle of years. Lot of very important species of fishes have been lost because of this indiscriminate trawling and juvenile fishing. Next, because of the lack of time, I'm just posing to, I'm just giving you a broad idea. I have not got approval to carry the same in a webinar beyond Mayoga. That's the thing. So now Kerala also, Kerala is one of the state which started fishing from a very long period of time. That was commercial fishing also. But in that state is also very good stringent measures are being taken. But nowadays, what is happening, the enforcement, because of the weak enforcement, we could not catch hold of all the people, and the resources are lost in a very way. Next one. So this is called a Chinese dip net. So this Chinese dip net, it is in practice for the past 100 or 200 years in Kerala backwaters. This is lowered during the low tide, and once in 15-20 minutes, it is being taken up and down. Those who have visited Kerala would have definitely seen this. It is taken up and down every 15-20 minutes based on the catch. It is operated by a motor. Everything is operated from a wooden platform. This is a very good method which is being followed, and very interesting thing also. So when I saw that one of the coordinators put this very interesting picture for me. Next one. So in Andhra Pradesh is one of the areas where you get a lot of tuna resources. Every coast and every state landings have uniqueness in them. So Andhra Pradesh is very important for its tuna resources. Tuna is a very nutritious fish. But unfortunately, I do not know, most of the people in India is not consuming tuna. I do not know the thing, but completely it is being exported from India. Everybody outside India is in need of tuna. Here we don't have a local market for tuna, and that is what this slide says. And next is the Odisha thing. Odisha has Chilka backwaters, and that backwater fishing is also a very important fishery in the case of Odisha. Next one. So West Bengal, if you see, I got an opportunity to work under an emeritus scientist from Central Institute of Fisheries Education. He was a Bengal, a retired scientist. He told me, I have not checked this fact myself. He told me, in West Bengal, Brahmins also, there are a lot of Bengalis out here, they might be able to correct me. In West Bengal, Brahmins also eat this hilsa. Hilsa is considered a vegetarian thing in West Bengal. Maybe it is little exaggerated, otherwise it is true. 100% I do not know. But that type of need, that is a very relishable fish in West Bengal. And this has been, next slide, this has been conserved also well in West Bengal. Because next slide after. So, next one. So, the matter for conserving this is, they very well know that if we are utilizing hilsa like this, we will lose the total hilsa stock, and Bengalis cannot live without hilsa. So they have made a minimum legal size for the catching of hilsa, and they have kept, one of my West Bengal friends was telling, in Tamil Nadu or otherwise in any state, only catching juvenile fish is a crime. In West Bengal, if you catch a juvenile hilsa and if you carry it in your bag for the afternoon curry, then police will enter your house and they will arrest you. That kind of powers have been accorded for the hilsa. So these are some of the crafts. These are some of the cages used in catching fishes from West Bengal. So whatever you are seeing here are cages which are so this is a conservation plan of hilsa fishing. Next. So fishery of Tamil Nadu. I have kept it Tamil Nadu because I should not stay a lot of time in Tamil Nadu. I actually told my counterpart to attend to this session. I have not taken much thing. Tamil Nadu has a very good resource of fish and fishery resources, crab resources. Why? Because we are having a lot of nursery grounds in Tamil Nadu. Gujarat also has Gulf of Kutch, Gulf of Kambar, and like that here Gulf of Mannar, which is a biological paradise, and which has 3,200 varieties of fishes. I've seen only 1,400 are commercially important. We are exploiting only 263, and here there is 3,200. These are figures which I have read from the scientific reports. The park bay. The park bay is just like a pond, only 9 meter in depth, 27, 9 meter, 9 into 3, 27 each only. It's called a sea. And the very unfortunate thing in park bay is they do bull trawling. They do pair trawling in park bay, and completely they are destroying the seagrass beds and all the resources. Next nursery ground is the Pichavaram mangrove forest. I will not say a word about it because the colossal of mangrove research has spoken 2 days earlier by day. So credit to him. Everybody will know that Dr. Maslamani himself is a very big man in the mangroves. So I will not touch it. Next one. I should not touch it. Next one. So these are some of the problems with the unsustainable trawling. Here, the normal allowed horsepower of a boat is 240 horsepower. But very interestingly, it is like fitting a bicycle with a 300 horsepower engine and riding in our gutted roads. So they have horsepower engine 800, 500, 600 horsepower engines are there. They will completely drain out the resources. Complete resource depletion is there in Tamil Nadu. Next one. So threats to the marine fisheries. So marine fisheries under threat, as my earlier slide showed, 2007 we were humans. Now we are experts and we are turning inhuman towards our fishery resources. It is inhuman. We are catching all the juveniles. We are doing blast fishing. If you can kill a fish with poison, then we will do it. Whatever we do, we will do it indiscriminately. That Vladimir Zelensky, he is the prime minister of Ukraine, very young person, 40 years old, and he is an actor. He told, don't hang my photo in your offices. Hang the photos of your children before you take any decision. Hang the photos of your children in your offices before you take any to his ministers. Why? We are doing everything for our children. We are building house for our children. We are doing everything. But finally, if we deplete all the resources, what will our children do? So whatever decision taking we are taking today should be in the interest of our children. Our thing, if we live for another 110 years also, in another 50 years the life is over. Right? So we have to leave our resources to our younger generation, and we don't have the right to deplete anyway. So due to coastal pollution, harmful algal blooms are coming. I myself witnessed for the first time in my career of about 54-55 voyages here and there in the Bay of Bengal and Arabian Sea, just for fun. Whoever says, hey, we have come, I have gone in the boats. So this time only I got the opportunity to see a harmful algal bloom. I do not know whether it is harmful. Dr. Sandhanam is here. Sir will be able to tell whether I am going to send him some photos. Now only I remind him. Arabian Sea, there was an algal bloom for hundreds of kilometers, hundreds of nautical miles together. I have videographed it myself. I have photographed it myself. The last slide of mine is that only. How these are all coming? They are polluting the complete coastal systems. All these things are going to deplete the marine fisheries. Indiscriminate trawling is there. Blast fishing is there. Bull trawling is there. Completely higher speed engines are there. Small machines. 50 machines. How 50? Mosquitoes cannot enter. And even sand particles cannot escape out of that trials. So that type of and pollution. So wonderful things we are doing for the nature, and nature is also doing wonderful things for us. It has kept us already 4 months inside the house, and today is the first day I am getting after 4 months to see human faces and speak. So that only I am very emotional about speaking. I used to speak 2 meetings a day. Now for the 4 months I have kept shut in my room. My wife is only monitoring me, till she is beside me and monitoring me whether you should talk this much or that much. Okay. Santanam sir is laughing. Next one. So these are the threats. Overall, the MFRA, Marine Fisheries Regulation Act of every state, if it is followed itself, we will stop depleting the resources. Everybody says, I have my own vehicle, I will go into the sea. However, here, Central Institute of Fisheries Technology, CIFNET, whoever it is, their brains, I should say, when you go to the field, they will have different techniques for different exploitation, and that will be more unsustainable. So this type of things we should not be doing. We, in the sense, everybody is responsible. I am responsible, fishermen is responsible, bureaucrats are responsible, policy makers are responsible. But at the last, we should not finish our resources just in our generation. Next one, next one. I just wanted to talk about little. Then unreported, unregulated, illegal fishing. That is also a very bad process in our thing. Unreported means the boat doesn't have a registration number. It will go to the sea and it will bring fishes. Illegal means you cross the border, you go to Singapore, you go to Malaysia, you go to the Virgin Islands, anywhere in the world, catch fish and come sell in India. That is illegal fishing. So this type of fishing should not happen. Next one. Next one. So this is one. See the size of the net. See, with this net, when it is being trawled, nothing means not even a sand particle will escape out from the net. So this is a net which you put in your house for a mosquito net. You can sleep peacefully inside. But they are using this net for catching big fishes with a hand's length, half kg, 1 kg fishes. Only 10% will be that 1 kg fish. And everything others will be lost. So lost in the ocean. So now, for juvenile fishing is our major menace which we have to control. Legal, illegal, I am able to control somebody. Enforcement authorities are able to control, or they are not able to control. It is not being controlled as of now. Whatever it is, just one thing if we stop. And one thanks I will say, but the people of the world will not forgive me for saying this. I should thank this corona for regenerating these oceans. Really, we are getting lot of stocks in the ocean. We threatened nature, nature is threatening us. So now nature has a system that will replenish us on its own. It has its own balance. Now I could see the oceans getting back to normal. One more year shutdown like this, and I somewhere in a report, I'm planning to recommend put up a word to the government that every year, 1 month at least should be a lockdown. I do not know, people, if you don't agree, please spare me. So this, for catching, not catching this juvenile fishes, Minimum legal size means there is a minimum legal age for getting a driving license. There is a minimum legal age for getting married. So there should be a minimum legal size for a fish to be captured. That minimum legal size is ascertained based on the size at first maturity. At what time the fish ovaries mature, and what time it spawns, it lays eggs, right? And at that time, at least one season, it has to be given a time for its replenishment of the progeny. And only after that, that fish can be harvested. Now, fortunately for this, the Kerala government, the West Bengal government in the case of hillside is following. The Kerala government has put 58 species for, see, you can see in the screen, these are the minimum sizes. Now, below this size, if you bring, it is considered a juvenile and it is considered a illegal fishing. So these sizes are being done, but Dr. Abzal, who has produced this slide, told me nobody is behaving properly. Nobody brings this size. Everybody is bringing lower size than this one. So how are we going to control the system? Right? Oh, thank you. Next one. Next. So these are the 58 species notified by the Kerala government that is below the sizes, catching any fish is illegal. So net fish, we are the extension arm of Marine Products Export Development Authority. We are taking our best efforts. Our chief executive, Dr. Joyce Thomas, is a big conservationist in census. He is promoting the square mesh at Cardiff. We are promotional agency, and the Central Institute of Fisheries Technology has formulated this. That is the cod end, we have diamond shaped nets, and the diamond shaped nets will shrink when it is being dragged, but the square ends will be tied up in four counts. So whatever may be the drag pressure also, you can see in this photo, wherever may be the drag pressure, the small fishes will escape out of the square meshes, and only the small bigger fishes will be retained in the net. This is tied at the cod end. Cod end means the last portion of a trawl net. Okay. Now we are training continuously hundreds of people. Every year at least 200 to 400 persons are being trained to produce square meshes, square mesh net. This is for the conservation of the fishery resources. Next one. So now I have taken this photograph during one of the square mesh trial. See in the square mesh, Dr. Sir, show me the next photo also, next slide. So this photo has only retained the bigger sized fishes, and all the small sized fishes have come down. So this for experimental purposes, we have put the outer diamonds. So that square mesh has retained all the bigger size. The earlier photo show it is a close-up shot. Dr. Maslam. So the larger sized fishes are only retained in the square mesh, and smaller fishes have come out. Come out means we have put a diamond outer, and only this is for an experimental trial. And in that experimental trial itself, we got a very good result. Next slide. Next. Next. So this. Previous. So this is the type of fishes when we trawl using a square mesh. Bigger fishes. So the fisherman gets lot of gain with his bigger fishes. With the smaller nets, the drag pressure increases. The diesel expense increases. So all benefits they are having. Only thing they should show. Hear us, and they have to change the pattern like this. Next. So we are promoting by means of meetings, trainings every day. Next one. Fisheries College has also joined with us, and we have put a lot of vernacular language booklets also to promote conservation. Next one. Next. So this is a training. Wherein we have shown the fishermen how to convert the existing diamond shape into square mesh. So if at all they have to buy a new one, they have to spend money. For buying a new one also, EMBDA is giving 50% subsidy for getting square mesh cards. And more than that, we are doing training to change their existing diamond shape nets into a square without any cost. Next. So we are meeting people, college people are motivated to meet the people, and we are spreading the message. Next. Next one. These are our extension activities. We are promoting by means of wall painting. Whatever means we can take it to the society that this is good, we are telling. Next. Next, our pamphlets. So the laws which are governing us are very important. Here there are about 6 laws which are given, laws and bills. But the Wildlife Protection Act 1972, it prohibits catching any prohibited Schedule 1 or animals in the sea. It prohibits. So turtles come under that, sea horses, sea cucumbers. So marine biology experts will know a lot of things. So these are prohibited under Wildlife Protection Act 1972. This is unbailable. Salman Khan, you remember, na? He killed a man, that is a deer, and was is still behind. He has crores of money is coming in and out, but when we go inside, we cannot come out. That is the difference between Salman Khan shooting a man and we catching a turtle and bringing it home. Okay, then Environment Protection Act of 1986 is also governing this. Most of all, covering everything, the parent law of fisheries is Marine MFRs, Marine Fishing Regulation Act. Each state has its own MFRs. Tamil Nadu has Tamil Nadu Marine Fisheries Regulation Act. Okay, so everybody has to follow that act, or else it will be enforced. Next one. So we are doing regulatory measures by having closed fishing season. East coast is having 61 days ban. West coast is also having 61 days ban. That is a closed. Then marine protected areas are there. Protected species are there. Mesh size regulation is there. What is the mesh size regulation of Tamil Nadu? 35 millimeter at garden. 35 millimeter should be at the garden. Now people started using 25, reduced to 20. Now 15, 16. Now at the card end there, people are using 16 to 18 mm mesh size, through which sand cannot pass. So this is trash fishing, and this is a loss to the biodiversity of our coastal waters and Indian continent. Then we have to use turtle excluder device to exclude the turtles from when it is caught. If you don't exclude it, the system will exclude us. One way by the law, and another way by not having turtles in the sea, and the ocean will be full of jellyfishes. Next one. So government is taking a lot of efforts to promote fishery. So from 2015 to 2020, we have spent about 2 lakh crores on it. Approximately 40 crores in the first session, about 15-16. And now we are spending about 770 to 800 crores per year. The central government, in participation with the states, is spending a lot of money to promote fishing. Next. So now we went for a deep sea fishing trial. Now only the coastal waters are completely exploited. The continental shelf region is gone. The EEZ is only forest. We cannot fish beyond that. We have to have other things. We have EEZ is our land. Okay. So we took a voyage funded by the Marine Products Export Development Authority. I stayed in the sea for 20 days there to learn tuna hook and line fishing. So there is plenty of resources in the sea, plenty of resources. When we cross this continental shelf, it is like that, what is our town traffic. But when once we cross the continental shelf area outside, it is like that highways, nobody is here. Only people from the southern Kanyakumari district, they are fishing in Karwar waters, coastal waters of Gujarat, everything is their land only. So I went with them, stayed in the sea for 20 days, saw whatever they are doing. we have to congratulate the fishermen for putting so much effort for their livelihood. They are very sturdy people. They are very big technicians. We cannot put one knot whatever they are putting for a hook and line. After so many days of training, also, I wonder, I am really thoughtful whether I can adopt their skill. So skillful. They catch tuna 80 kgs, 90 kgs, 120 kgs. So that is the horizon which is left for us. Deep sea fishing. Now also 20,000 crores, of which 9,500 crores is the government share. Government is promoting fisheries, especially deep sea fisheries. So we will engage people by our knowledge in deep sea fisheries for a better tomorrow. Next. Probably this is the end. Now I have to thank people, thank our organization for permitting me to come here and present. The organizing committee of Satya Bhama, very renowned elder scientists like Chandrasekharan sir, and so many, I could see only his face here, and so many elite members of the research community, Sandhanam sir, Maslamani sir, and your HOD, he is not visible today, Dr. Ramesh. I was thinking Dr. Ramesh is a research scholar, so young, so energetic.
Thank you, sir.
Compliment him. Dr. Ramesh is here, but I cannot see you in the screen. So I really congratulate your team, your chancellors, the HOD, my very, very good friend, Maslamani sir, my senior. We have stayed together in a storm together for 10 days. No water, no food. 10 eggs we had. We survived for 10 days with 10 eggs and 2 loaves of bread. What we ate, how we survived, we do not know. Same thing is going on. So with that, Dilip has called me also for this lecture. I thank him profusely. And most profoundly, I thank the participants who are the heroes of this session. So I think somebody, one professor was telling me, webinar, when my webinar starts, 150 people will be there. So when I leave, 20% will be there. That will be the case for your webinar also. Then he told, even though I am producing 200 taxonomical features of fishes, nobody is really willing to hear. I do not know by the end of the day how many have survived in my webinar. I thank them profusely and thank everyone for giving this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful lecture, sir. And all of Kadresan sir's students have his own way of presenting wonderfully, sir. And you too have the same, sir. Thank you. Thank you for that wonderful presentation.
I have been brewed. I don't take the credit. How I presented, I do not know. But I will take the credit of being brewed by 2 persons. One is
sir.
Professor Kadresan for 3 years.
Okay,
and
sir.
For Professor Kannan for 3 years. So
okay,
both the people, right, I have learned so many details sitting them with them for about 6 to 7 years. Detailing of slide preparation something. But my slides were not dressed up properly today because of the lack of time. Otherwise, I would have put some pop-ups here and there.
Okay.
But somehow, if your participants enjoyed, then that is okay.
It is nice, sir. They have enjoyed, and we have a lot of questions also from them, sir.
Definitely.
I would like to put forward some of them, sir. It's a general question from one of the participants, whether high population land or high population and oil spills might affect or have an impact on marine fishes, sir, the fish
definitely.
Industry.
Obviously. First thing the oil does to a fish is it will cling to the gills of the fish. Finished. If somebody closes your nose and mouth, over. No corona, nothing. Finished. Close the mouth and the nose. This is what happens to our oil spill. Fish's gills will be choked with oil. Fish's will get killed. It will kill the food on which the fish feeds, so that also that animal will be, that species will be eliminated temporarily from that.
Sir, another question is there a possibility of re-establishing the depleted stocks lost by overfishing?
It is possible. See, everything, sea is a mighty ocean. We call the ocean a mighty ocean. So you cannot scrape out everything. Whatever is happening is, it is called as rotation of crops in a land. Okay. So one eminent scientist, Dr. M. S. Swaminathan, was telling during Green Revolution, put manure, you add fertilizer to your farm, you grow things in a very quick manner, you put pesticides, but there should be a rotation of crop. You have to put manure in between. So one time if you put a rice, next time you should put banana and jowar. You like so in fishing also, during one season there should be trawling, next season there should be gill netting, hook and line. So if you alternate like this, so definitely you can replenish the stock. And this type of lockdowns also, now we are having 61 days ban period for each post. So there is a replenishment, and we have to protect the stocks by obeying the marine fisheries regulation acts.
Sir, maybe one participant who is an ardent fish lover has asked a question of whether COVID-19 will affect the fish industry, fish products.
See, COVID-19 has definitely affected the fish industry. There is no second say about that. Because the production is has come to about, we are at a 20-30% production scale. There is deprivation of movement of things, and also in movement in the sense international movement. When you only have flights and other things operating freely, then only your export starts to go. When there is more lesser demand, your price will also go down. And also this COVID fear is with everybody. Though COVID doesn't affect the fishes, everybody might think, yeah, at some period of time it will come for chicken, if you eat some flu you will get. Things like that are there. So the foreign countries will also force a lot of stringent, make more stringent their categorization of checking. So there will be definitely an effect.
Yes, sir. And maybe another person who likes to eat fish has asked a question. He's from West Bengal, sir. The seashore fishermen leave one type of puffer fish because they are toxic to eat. Are they really toxic or are they useless, sir?
In Japan, there is a culinary called tofu, T-O-F-U, tofu.
Okay,
so puffer fishes were thrown 10 years earlier till it was thrown up, realizing that it is toxic, it is poisonous. Okay, there is a difference between a toxin and a poison. All poisons are not toxins, but all toxins are poisons. Okay. So, definitely, the tofu is a food product, and only certified cooks in Japan can cook tofu. So, whoever knows to deal with that can deal with that. And it has an export value also to Japan.
There is another question regarding this same puffer fishes, sir, whether they create havoc in Odisha in the river Mahanadi fish biodiversity. Are they affected by these puffer fishes?
This is a very specific question about Odisha.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
If at all, I think one Mr. Atanu Ray is here. He can answer this question. Mr. Dr. Atanu, he is from West Bengal.
Okay, sir.
Puffer fish, why is telling that it is causing havoc in the coast of Odisha? Whether there is explosive landings there? Why he is asking?
No, sir. He is. It's a general question that he has put forward. Sir.
In what way is it affecting?
In what way is it affecting the biodiversity of the river Mahanadi fish?
Now, see, I am a general physician. See, now an expert has raised hands. Dr. Santanu.
Yes, sir.
Actually, yeah. Let me first appreciate Dr. Vinod Ravindran for his excellent and enthusiastic lecture. I am very happy. I was really enjoyed listening your lecture after a long long time gap. when we were in CAC marine biology, actually I used to come to your class for practical class for writing the question of plankton.
Yes.
Okay, that time itself I realized you became a very good scientist one time. One fine morning. So you proved my dream.
Your
lecture was really excellent, and it covers an overview of fisheries resources, especially the marine fishery resources of our country. And very excellent lecture, and really this lecture will be a very, very much useful to the budding scientists. There is no doubt about that. Okay.
Thank you.
And my compliments and appreciation. I am very happy to see here my juniors. My juniors, my friends are flourishing like anything. Yes. Dr. Rafi is here, Dr. Masalamani is here, yes. Dr. Vinod Ravindran, Tunavkarasu, they are my juniors. I'm happy to see the developments. This all because of our teachers. So we should salute our teachers, those who build us, those who bring us into this stage. Okay. My compliments, appreciation. Thanks for your nice lecture. Excellent lecture.
Thank you very much, sir.
And regarding the buffer fish, actually, buffer fish is a carnivorous fish. They can eat on small fish, larvae, and other zooplankton. But there's no report so far available because of buffer fish, the biodiversity is depleting. Because if it is a good system, there should be a tiger, there should be a deer. Okay, yes. Deal. So like that in marine ecosystem, we need both all the tropic organisms. Then only the system will be balanced, equally balanced. Okay, but I wish to tell one thing. In future, due to climate change or global warming, there are two types of organisms going to exist in the ocean. One is buffer fish, another one is jellyfish. Okay, so jellyfish is not at all fish. Which comes under the megalozooplankton or gelatin zooplankton, but these two organisms are expected to be there in the ocean if the present global warming or climate change is continued. So before that, as Dr. Vinod Ravindran has pointed out, we should develop some technique to use the non-edible buffer fishes to bring into the edible one. Of course, it is already practicing in Japan. There are some trained cooks are there who is preparing the buffer fish. There is a specialized restaurants are there in Japan. So not all the buffer fishes are toxic. Most of the buffer fishes are toxic. There are some buffer fishes are edible. We can just remove the toxic gland and rest of the flesh will be the edible. But we have to identify those buffer fishes are edible or those buffer fishes are not edible. That is the thing we have to identify, then later we can recommend for edible purpose. And another thing regarding the bloom, algal bloom, as Dr. Ravindran rightly pointed out, in recent days due to climate change or global warming and pollution, especially nutrient pollution, there are frequent algal blooms are reported recent days, especially in India, especially in Gulf of Mannar region, Gulf of Mannar Biosphere Reserve. Very recently, the North Inuka blooms have been reported. Okay, and the cyanobacteria, trichodesmia bloom, and other dinoflagellates blooms are very frequent blooms are reported. Nowadays, this may be due to the climate change, global warming, or nutrient pollution, especially nutrient pollution. So this is one of the emerging pollutant in the ocean. Definitely, the algal blooms will deplete marine resources. Once the algae turn into a toxic one, that will affect the entire marine biodiversity. For that, actually, the prevention measures should be taken. Prevention measures should be taken to control the algal bloom. By the only thing, we have to treat the wastewater. The treated wastewater will be discharged into the ocean. And same time, we can also think on some alternative methods or alternative fossil fuel, biofuels or bioenergy, which is responsible for replacing the fossil fuel, which is responsible for climate change or global warming. So these are the things I would like to emphasize here. I once again thank and congratulate the speakers, today's speaker, Dr. Ravindran, and I congratulate the organizers, Dr. Masalamani, Dr. Ramesh Kumar sir. Actually, there are very good appreciation in the chat box.
Yes.
The participants, they are enjoyed and they are given very good feedback. And this is a very good webinar. Like that, there are a lot of appreciations and compliments are there. So I too join with the participants and in appreciating and congratulating the organizing team. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And as I've already said, we almost have the same 130 participants, around 130-140 participants in Zoom itself. We also have some participants in YouTube who have joined us in YouTube. They have also asked us some questions, sir. Is there any data about fish breeding for each species and why they ban there is a ban in particular season?
See, actually the fisheries ban is based on the research to our government of India. The advisory committee comprises of Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute, Fishery Survey of India, and only based on their input the breeding period is being researched, and only after that research these type of plans are being implemented. It is not one day we go to the shore and say that there is less stuff. So based on a long term research only these type of plans are being imposed to any species.
Thank you, sir. So I guess we have taken too much time. So is there any other person who wants to talk to Dr. Ravindran, sir? Sir, Dr. Chandrasekharan, sir?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Ravindran, it was...
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. So it was very nice. And it was like a guided tour through marine capture fisheries. I was away from this marine capture fisheries for about 20 years since I joined SIBA. So it was like a bit nostalgic for me to listen to the catching methods, crafts and gears and all. And some issues that comes to my mind. See, there are some high-valued species which have been over-exploited. The catch. See, they have been... Stock depletion has taken place as reported by CMFRI. Yes. And there are some species which have been exploited. They have not yet been exploited properly. And as somebody was telling about this breeding pattern and all, so I think the policymakers, they should incorporate all these biological data into the fishing policy. And this is about biology. And regarding the deep sea fishing and offshore fishing and all, beyond EEZ, are we permitted beyond EEZ for fishing?
International waters, sir. There is a provision of going and getting our fish, but we have to take due permissions from us.
Because Fishery Survey of India, they have been doing a lot of work. So their duty is to make a stock assessment of each and every square mile of our water bodies, particularly in the oceans. So that data should also be used for proper exploitation of the fishery resources. If we are over-exploiting, it is a sin to the ecology what it is existing, and if we are not properly utilizing the fishery wealth which is available with us, so it is a sin to our human inhabitants of the country. We have not provided enough protein to our people through fishing. So okay, thank you
very much, sir. You are kind of senior persons participating in the webinar is a very great encouragement for us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. And one more thing that I would like to add is that what sir has already said, the 1 month complete lockdown that sir is prescribing to the government, and many people are for it. And I would also like to support the initiative, sir, because I hope all those who support nature will be supporting this theory. And now we are in a 4 month lockdown, probably a 1 month lockdown or a 1 week lockdown at least will surely restore nature in its own way. Thank you very much, sir.
We will run a campaign.
Yes, sir. Sure, sir. Maslamani, sir.
Govindan sir, hello.
Yes, sir. Mass Lamani sir. Yeah, Govindan sir.
Yes, sir.
Would you like to add some words?
Dr. Ravindran sir, your presentation is well and good.
Thank you very much.
I want only one question from your.
It's not audible. I'm not hearing you properly.
Dr. Govindan, your audio is not clear. Yes. Check your audio. Mic.
He can close his video, then audio will be better.
What? Oh, some network is there. Some network. All the best. Thank you.
Dr. Sir.
Yes, sir. We have.
Dr. Sir is here. Hello,
yes, sir.
Can I speak?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it's my token of duty to reciprocate to Dr. Vinod too. Congratulations, Dr. Vinod, for the wonderful lecture.
Thank you, sir.
I too second Dr. Chandrasekharan, sir, because you have made a virtual tour from straight away from the coast of Gujarat to Andaman. So thank you very much. That's an excellent presentation. I have only one thing to tell. You should be disseminated to the students. That is that the MBDA, the NetFish, has some programs, especially coastal cleanup, like you said, this awareness program. Can you tell in brief so that it will be beneficial to the students who are participating?
Yeah. As far as the students are concerned, we are involving them in any community-based program. Usually the students meet, whether it is via NSS meet, otherwise general class students, we are taking them to the field for such a coastal cleanup in World Oceans Day, World Environment Day, Swachh Bharat program. All the students are taking participating in our program. Moreover, there is a Sea Club program funded by the NetFish, in a lot of fisheries universities. So through the Sea Club program, also we conduct seminars, one-day seminars, brainstorming sessions, drawing competitions to disseminate about the sustainable hygienic handling and whatever is relevant to the marine. And they can visit with us to the processing plants. Such type of programs are also there. So we closely work with the students. From school students to college students.
Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. I guess we have come to the end of the session. We have overshooted a lot of time. So once again, I thank today's speaker for the wonderful lecture. And at the same time, I would like to share with the participants, please do join us on Monday. Tomorrow is a day off. On Monday, we'll be having another speaker, Dr. D. Ajay Bhaskar, who's a nutritionist and aqua feed consultant, Rajahmundry, Andhra Pradesh, who will be giving a lecture on fish nutrition and feed formulation. Thank you for joining us today. Have a wonderful weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye, all, sir. Thank you, bye, sir. Bye, thank bye, you very bye. Much, sir. Thank you.